Hi, my name is Dr. Daniel Cantor, and I'm the president of the Florida Society of Neurology and the medical director of Neurologique, an organization dedicated to patient-centered care, research, and education. I'm really happy to be here again with MS World to bring you more exciting data. We heard yesterday about one of the medications called IV alemtuzumab. We've heard a lot about another medication called oral BG00012, so BG12, and then another medication that we'll probably see even before BG12, we're not sure yet, is called oral teriflunomide. So I am so happy to be here to have the opportunity of a fellow Canadian where we can talk about this medication called teriflunomide. Dr. Mark Freedman is professor of neurology and the director of the multiple sclerosis research unit at the University of Ottawa. So thank you so much for joining us.
Pleasure, Danny. Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you. Tell us a little bit about teriflunomide. What should patients know now? What are the kind of research things that you're talking about?
Well, even though teriflunomide's new to the MS world, teriflunomide's been in trials for MS for a decade. We started our first trial with this in 2001. We remember this well because the investigator meeting was on 9/11, so we all recall meeting the people for the first time. And this drug has actually got a history through its parents. The parent drug, leflunomide, has been on the market for years for rheumatoid arthritis, and with a lot of similarities, but the problem with the parent drug was liver toxicity, which has now more or less been quelled by the breakdown product to teriflunomide, which seems to be much safer. So this is probably one of the most extensively studied drugs in multiple sclerosis because it's got a wide program with numerous trials.
Yeah, we've talked about how some medications like cladribine, we had one phase 3, and some of them we have two.
These are three. There's three
and
here.
And they're all got T in their name, and we have Tower.
Tower, Tenir, and Temso, and Temso 2, just Temso 1 and Temso 2.
Keep going.
Now it's Teracles and Topic.
Okay.
Yeah, it gets a little rolling off the tongue, but
and
all of these...
We've talked about it a little bit, is that I was an investigator in the phase 2 trials,
right,
comparing where we added to teriflunomide, we added teriflunomide to either interferon or to glucuronidate.
Right, yeah, right. So that was a very interesting study, of course, because that's now being published in Neurology probably this month. And the result was totally unexpected. It was a safety trial because the concern with the liver toxicity was that adding that to interferon may upset the balance very much so. We didn't see that. Instead, what we saw was something very unique, that patients who are otherwise doing well on interferon actually have quite a bit of activity on their MRIs, and that could be driven down 80-90% with the addition of teriflunomide. And if you did the math and you look at Temso, the effects on MRI were not as high as that.
Okay.
So it scored much higher in combination with interferon. Obviously, interferon alone wasn't able to turn down the MRI.
But there's some synergy that's going on.
Well, I didn't say it.
You can't say it,
yeah,
but I can.
We think it's safer just to say there's an additive effect.
Okay.
Whether it's truly one really promoting the other in terms of synergy is a very interesting question. It's the first time we've seen a combination therapy that looks like, first of all, very well tolerated, and that may be superior to the first-line therapy of interferon.
Why do you think with the glatiramer acetate, we've talked about it before, we talked about it last year, also, why do you think that there wasn't that same added benefit?
Well, there was. It just wasn't as dramatic as with interferon. And remember, this was not a population that was chosen based on any exclusion criteria.
It was really easy to put people in. You just said, we'll add placebo or we'll add oral.
So if you wanted to, for whatever inherent bias, people choose to put certain patients onto glatiramer and other patients onto interferon, and are they the same patient populations? Obviously not.
Okay.
And so there was these differences could be easily driven by the fact
that baseline. So what did Temso show us?
So Temso is, of course, the phase 3 first registry trial, large one, that looked at teriflunomide 2-dose, same 2 doses in the last 10 years, by the way, never changed those 2 doses, so there's flexibility there. In the last 10 years, we've never really seen a problem that would knock out the 14 milligram dose. We've always seen trends that favored the 14 milligram, and that's exactly what happened in Temso. There was a dose-dependent effect on things like MRI, where the 14 milligram exceeded just a bit the 7, although both doses were effective at reducing relapses, both doses effective at reducing the MRI, and a slight favoring of the high dose, 14 milligram dose on EDSS progression.
Now, a lot of our patients, obviously, are young, fertile females. Some of us know, we've talked about in the past, that leflunomide has a voluntary category X.
Yeah.
So what do we think is going to happen? Do you have any...
I think there's been 11 pregnancies so far in the TEMSO study, and some of them were electively aborted, some spontaneously, and then there was a live birth. But I think one of the best things about teriflunomide is that it's readily washed out of the body.
Yeah.
You can take this cleansing cholestyramine course for a week, and there's almost no trace of teriflunomide.
So when we talk about natalizumab, we've talked before about plasmapheresis and cleaning up the plasma.
It takes a while.
Alemtuzumab, we've talked about how it has a profound effect, but you can't wash it out. Here we can wash out, so we can reverse.
So it's very safe. Nobody's had any problems with teriflunomide. It's got a surprisingly good 10-year safety record.
Yeah, that really is surprising. Yeah. So some of us were scared, but it actually looked... I remember I famously said, wow, about BG12 last year when I got up, and we've talked about it. But I remember when TEMSO was presented, I remember a doctor turning to me and saying, that's it. We got the oral medicine we're going to use.
Yeah, it's very safe. Very simple. A little hair thinning, but you know, some of us would never notice that.
Yeah. And so we've talked also about how our sources of information are ECTRIMS, the European Committee on Treatment and Research in MS, and we're going to be reporting again this year, American Academy of Neurology, and press release. So there's another trial called TENIER. Can you describe what we know from the press release, what's publicly available?
Well, if I could just add one more thing about TEMSO, which is really the new thing.
Absolutely.
Which I have to get down to my poster to present. Well, there are two new things. So the one question that was sort of looming is attacks aren't just attacks, right? There's everybody's focusing now on severity of attacks because the number of attacks are so small that you're moving people from nothing to even more nothing. You know, you could argue that 0.3 attacks per year is, you know, would have been a dream 10 years ago. And that's what the placebos are doing.
Right.
So what about the severity? And so one of the things that they looked at as a subgroup analysis where they looked at attacks that put people off their feet, severe attacks, hospitalized attacks, significant reduction in those, you know, meaningful attacks. And then there's this other metric that we're all trying to push a little bit, and not everyone buys into it. And there was a very good editorial in the new journal called MS and Related Disorder by Fred Lubman. It's the notion of being disease activity free. Now, that's a bit of a, you know, funny term, because the best way to be disease activity free is never to look.
Right.
So the more you look, the more you find. And so all the trials are a little bit different in that those that have more plentiful MRIs are going to have fewer disease-free patients. So that's just the inherent to it. But everyone's looking at that because you can independently look at outcome measures like relapse, progression, and MRI. But wouldn't it be more meaningful if the patient who didn't have a relapse also did not have any new MRI lesions, also did not progress?
So overlapping Venn diagrams, and you want to have all three to be best.
You'd have to have all three to be disease activity free. Whereas, if you can imagine, you could have some patients who, oh, look, they didn't have a relapse, that's good.
Right.
But what if that same patient had 2-point EDSS progression? Well, that's bad. So you can't be counted as bad and good.
Right.
But you could in the current scenario, because they're all independent analyses. Disease activity free statistic looks at you have to be free of all three. And it's much harder to demonstrate that. There were 60% more disease activity free patients on 14 milligrams of teriflunomide. That's the poster. I think that's an important message.
Well, we'll come down for that too. But now, just looking at TENIER, what can you say publicly from what we've seen?
Well, that's another registry trial. And it was an interesting one because it also addresses what the European authorities have been asking for, which is it's not enough just to show us that the drug's effective. We need to somehow feel how this drug will compare to the current incumbent first-line therapies.
Right.
Give us a sense of this. Now, to do a true head-to-head would have been an enormous trial, and you'd have to randomize.
Right.
The next best thing is to, what you do is you get a prospective active comparator arm. So patients who are being placed on one of the other therapies who will then be followed prospectively with your test group.
Okay.
And then you get some comparative analysis, though it's not the true randomization
right.
that really addresses head-to-head. And so that Tenere took on interferon beta-1A sub-Q 44.
Right.
Rebif.
Yes.
Which alemtuzumab has taken on and beaten. And everybody forgets that, you know, they look at the alemtuzumab data and they go, well, that's about comparable to what we saw with, you know, BG12.
Right, we're probably it's not against
the placebo. You know, you're taking on
high-dose, high-frequency
interferon. So this is what Tenere did in the hope of being able to demonstrate not just that there may be a difference in efficacy,
mm-hmm.
but effectiveness.
Okay.
Which is a different animal because patients only benefit from the drugs they actually take.
Right.
So if you have to stop the therapy because you can't tolerate the injections, flu-like symptoms, etc., that go along with interferon,
mm-hmm.
well, then at the end of the road, you're not going to benefit from it.
Okay.
So the end point in this study was not only the time to a new event like a relapse, it was the time to treatment failure and inability to maintain the therapy.
Okay.
And then you count up all your eggs at the end of the trial, and what they saw was really, the quote is, no superiority over Rebif. But in fact, the high dose was no different in terms of relapse control. And since more patients were able to stay on the teriflunomide, I'd have to say the advantage went in the direction of teriflunomide.
Yeah, we've talked about it before that one of the issues with BG12, although we saw some exciting data, is that it's twice a day and also being studied three times a day, which is obviously harder than once a day. We know a lot of us, I always ask doctors, I say, who prescribes antihypertensive drugs? And they raise their hand. I say, how many people think all their patients take it? They don't think so. I say, wait a second. How many people here in the room are supposed to be taking it themselves? And how many do? And all the doctors are like, yeah, I don't do it. But you mentioned something very interesting, which is the severity of the relapse. Can you kind of speculate, do you think it's about the location or it's about the amount of inflammation, or do we not know why that would be different? Real estate matters in MS.
Yeah, it does. It does. You know, eloquent locations will produce a lot of symptoms and could completely disable where the same lesion placed elsewhere in the nervous system would do nothing. I think it's also a matter of how it affects an individual.
Mm-hmm.
There are relapses that cause nothing but fatigue, which okay. aren't going to alter your EDSS.
Right.
But if it's bad enough that it took you or me off our feet, we couldn't function for a week,
right.
that's a pretty severe attack.
Yeah.
So it's the definition of severity, unfortunately, isn't uniform. But for the analyses that we were talking about, no one would argue that a relapse where somebody was bad enough they had to be hospitalized, that's a bad relapse.
Well, you know, we're in real time, and in real time, you have to get downstairs.
Yes.
So thank you so much for joining us, and we'll be talking more about all these exciting treatments.
Great.
Thank you.
I see you.